The name of this video is Parallel Plate Capacitor. This is the first example, the main example we are going to consider in this course, of capacitors, which again are made as a system of two conductors, which we already examined in a previous video. So let us consider two conducting plates, which is two planes, okay, of conducting material. Of course, in real life, this must have a finite thickness and a finite area. We will discuss about these assumptions in a few minutes. So these conducting materials eventually will be in macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium. They're homogeneous, made from the same material in normal conditions as always. So the first plate, let's sketch it. So of course the plates are two plates like my hands in this fashion, like two plates like this. Okay, so I'm looking at these two plates facing each other from this side, like this kind of view. And so I will just sketch the side view here. This is the left plate facing this plate at some distance small d. There is another plate parallel to it. This distance let us call it small d. The thickness of each of these two plates, which is the same for both plates, we call it small t. The area of one of these plates, we call it capital A. It's this area here. So all these four areas are all capital A's. And eventually we want to consider this thickness to be very small compared to D. So the typical assumption we are going to make for this object is to assume, the first assumption is that small t is much smaller than small d. So the thickness of this plate is negligible compared to the distance between them. It is actually still good to consider some thickness when, if we want to somehow understand qualitatively what's going on in this system of conductors, okay? So we want to remember that these are actually conductors. So the conductor is everywhere here. The rest is all vacuum. So it's good, in my opinion, to keep some thickness, but eventually, mathematically, we will go in the limit for t which goes to 0+. But physically, we just say that t is much smaller than d. Okay. The other condition we want also to use is that effectively, if I were an observer living within this parallel plate capacitor, within this construction, and I imagine that the symbol for this construction in electric circuits, it's like this. By no chance, it resembles these plates which I'm sketching here. So I want to consider these plates as if they were infinitely large. Okay, in real life, again, this we cannot do. So in real life, physically, we would just impose the square root of A, which has units of meter, because A is a meter square. So this has to be much larger. So the linear dimensions of these plates has to be much larger than the distance small d between them. So effectively, under these conditions, we could consider these plates as if they were infinitely large, so infinite planes, similar to the infinite plane, in this case, double infinite plane of charge, which we studied in the beginning of this course. And in addition, the thickness is basically negligible, so it's effectively two planes of charge, which we studied in the beginning of this course, which is an idealization of the real life, which is expressed by these conditions down here. Now, this is actually very important what is coming up now. So let us assume that these two metallic plates, okay, are actually connected to a source, to a battery. We will come back to the concept of battery soon in one of the next videos. So for now, you don't have to understand exactly how a battery works, but you know more or less how a battery works. A battery has a positive and a negative polarities, okay? So supposed to connect a battery, the circuit element symbol for which is this. This is the plus side and this is the minus side of a battery. You've seen batteries, obviously. Okay, so this one is a DC battery. It also, the argument I'm doing here would also work with an AC source. So a source which generates a cosine of omega t or something like that. But for now, let's just take your little battery which you buy, okay? Which you power up any device you want. Okay, so let's connect the positive side, the positive pole of this battery. So let's say one point on the left plate. Okay, the left plate, incidentally, we are going to call it the region, the volume, the bulk, we're going to call it capital gamma 1. This one we're going to call it capital gamma 2. The surfaces, I will define them in a minute. So let's connect to a point on this left surface of capital gamma 1, the positive side of this battery. At the same time, let us connect the negative side of this battery to a point here on the surface. Note that this argument would work also if I were to connect this battery, let's say, to a point here or to a point here. It doesn't matter. So in fact, if you recall the video about the AM radio, if you go there to look into the details, we used a cylindrical capacitor in that case, which is different than a parallel plate capacitor. It's another one of the three main types of capacitors. So in that case, for example, I was touching with my battery, if you want, the outer surface on one plate of the capacitor and the inner surface on the other plate. It doesn't matter, okay? Because eventually, under equilibrium conditions, which is what we are going to go and instantaneously, you can assume this even for an alternating source, the electrostatic potential of one of these plates is the same everywhere, so it doesn't matter where I touch, okay? All right. So now, by means of this battery, we start to charge this object. There is always a transient, which we will study again when we will, in 342, we're going to study the transient of how to charge a capacitor. So it's a dynamic process during which positive charges, in this case, start to migrate in this direction. So the positive charges, which we sketch always actually in orange. So these positive charges will eventually start to populate this region here. So for example, there will be some positive charges here on this side. Since, of course, this is a single conductor, we are going to have also some positive charges on the other side. Okay, similarly, the negative side of this source will start to populate with negative charges, the negative side here, and similarly here. Now, in the transient, it's a little bit all messed up. So these charges start to populate these, the various spaces of these conductors in some fashion, okay? After the transient is reached, and the transient is always reached in the case of, for example, I don't know if I put a 3-volt battery here, eventually, if you wait some time, short time, you always reach a steady state conditions, during which I ask you the following question, which I want you to discuss in Piazza. The question is, after reaching the transient, so after reaching the transient, so in steady state, in steady conditions, the question I have for you in Piazza is, are the charges going to be distributed like I sketched them here, which was during the transient? That is, some charges on the left surface, some on the right surface, and similarly for gamma 2. Or maybe there will not be these charges here, and there will not be these charges here. There will be only positive charges on this right surface and negative charges on this left surface of gamma 1 and gamma 2, respectively. This is the question I have for you to discuss in Piazza. It's a very important question. Eventually, it should become apparent what has to happen in the following of this video, but I want that you stop this video for a few minutes and you think about that, because it's a very important concept. Okay. So now that you stopped the video and you thought about this a little bit, I can tell you what is the answer, but I'm not going to tell you the reason. So the answer is that actually this configuration is the one which is going to win in steady condition. So the positive charges are going to populate the right surface of capital gamma 1, whereas the negative charges, the left surface only. That is, on this external surface, there will be no charge, okay? All right, so now let's make a few definitions here. So since we already talked about this, let's make it a little bit more formal. The left surface of capital gamma 1, we call it capital sigma 1 left. The right surface, we call it capital sigma 1 right. The left surface of capital gamma 2, we call it capital sigma 2 left. And of course, this one we call it capital sigma 2 right. Great. So the other thing which we want to discuss here is that if we, under this assumption that the square root of A is much larger than B, basically we are considering these plates as if they were infinitely large. So really, you don't want to discuss about charge Q on the plates, rather sigma, the charge density. So whenever you have something which basically in the limit becomes an infinite surface, you really want to use, instead of Qs, you want to use the surface charge density sigma, which we assume is uniform and is given by the total charge Q, for example, the positive one, divided by the area A, okay? And of course, if you make this infinitely large, it will be a very large area, but a very large charge, and we want this ratio to be equal to sigma, okay? Which is a finite constant value. So there will be a plus sigma on capital sigma 1R, and there will be a minus sigma on capital sigma 2L. So there will be a plus sigma here, this plus sigma, and here there will be a minus sigma. Okay, great. Good. So now we know from previous problems of the infinite plane of charge, or the double layer, for example, the Helmholtz double layer, which we encountered previously in this course, which is pretty much an idealization of this scenario here, there are symmetry arguments, okay? So there is translation rotation symmetries, we've seen this before. Because of symmetries, which again, it's not like in the typical test, because of symmetry, we already studied those symmetries, so see previous videos. So now I'm entitled to say because of symmetries. So because of symmetries, which we now do understand, the only direction along which the electrostatic field, for example, for this configuration of charges is going to be is normal to these planes. And so in this case, we can define Cartesian coordinate system, where this one is the z-axis. You can call it x, but usually I call it z. And let's suppose that the origin is right there of this Cartesian coordinate system, x and y, I'm not going to sketch them. So we know that the electrostatic field is going to be uniform and directed only along the z direction, okay? Moreover, we can define the normal unit vector here at capital sigma 1L as n, the unit vector n, 1L. Similarly here, we are going to have n, 1, right? Here we're going to have, similarly, n to L, and this one will be n to right. For example, n1L, with respect to this coordinate system, which we have chosen here, is equal to minus uz. So keep this in mind, okay? Uz points in this direction, so this is minus uz. This will be plus, this will be plus, this is also minus. So you always need to represent these unit vectors with respect to the coordinate system we're considering, which is z in this case. Now I believe we have pretty much all the definitions we need in order to solve this problem. Actually, we already solved it. And in fact, we know that this is the problem of a double layer of charge. So we already know the result. So let's remind ourselves what the result is. For the electrostatic field, which I'm going to sketch in red as always, the electrostatic field will be So we can forget, suppose that now we reach macroscopic equilibrium, so we are in steady conditions, which actually means really macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium is reached. So since we reach macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium, so now we can assume that basically we can forget about the fact that there are these conductors, right? It's just a double layer charge. And so the electrostatic field of a double layer, we know that is zero outside the two layers. So it's going to be zero all the way to the origin here. And I leave it open because the electrostatic field, case two of Maxwell's equations of the electrostatic field, is discontinuous. And then eventually here we get a value which is going to be sigma divided by epsilon naught. So each of these is sigma divided by 2 epsilon naught, they sum up in a superposition, that's what we get. We've seen this already in the Helmholtz scenario, double layer, a few videos ago. And of course then it goes back to zero on the right-hand side. So we already know the result. So from this we could simply find from the definition E is equal minus gradient of V, the electrostatic potential, and then from that, for example, if you want to find the capacitance, which is the aim of this problem, we could proceed in that fashion, okay? In fact, we already have done the electrostatic potential in the Helmholtz double layer video. And so we could proceed like that to find the electrostatic potential, and from that we know that the capacitance is Q divided by delta V, and we solve the problem. So again, the aim of this problem now is to find C, the capacitance of this object, okay? Capacitor here. However, I don't want to follow that path. I want that we use as another example the Dirichlet problem. So let's use the Dirichlet problem, and to do so we need to split this region, this capacitor, into three regions. So there will be region one, which is here on the left-hand side, region two, which is here in the middle, and region three, which is here on the right-hand side. So what are these three regions mathematically? Well, region one is for any point z, in what, for what values of z, from minus infinite all the way to zero. And I put a bracket because we know that the electrostatic potential has to be continuous, so all these limiting points, they have to be included. The second region is within the two plates of the capacitor, so it's for Z, which is contained between zero and B. And as you can see here, I'm already hypothesizing that this T is very small, so we kind of forget about it. All right, but again, the reason why I still want to show it is because in a minute we are going to need some intuition there, which will help understand this problem, okay? And finally, three, z is in what region here? We are from B included to plus infinite. These are the three regions we want to study now by means of a Dirichlet problem. Okay, so in order to use the Dirichlet problem, we want to use first the Laplace equation in all the vacuum regions, then Coulomb's theorem, and then the continuity of the electrostatic potential. And perhaps in this case, to understand qualitatively what is going on, the macroscopic electrostatic equilibrium condition, which tells us that the electrostatic field is zero in these bulk materials, therefore the potential has to be constant in these regions all the way to the boundaries, to the surfaces, surfaces included. Okay, that's why I want to keep this thickness for that kind of intuition. All right. So of course you could just forget about the fact that we have conductors entirely and just model this with this double layer of charge, but I prefer really to look at the physics of this problem, so that's why I'm keeping it this way, and I want to solve the Dirichlet problem. So how do we proceed? Well, let's begin with region one. So in region one, we know that we are in vacuum. Again, this thickness is very small, so even though I'm going all the way over the conductor, it's pretty much all vacuum. So in all this vacuum, we can safely state that the scalar Laplacian of V, okay, we know that V, because of symmetries, I didn't complete the statement down here, obviously. I should have written something here. Because of symmetries, the only variable of interest is Z. This is the only degree of freedom of the system. So the degree of freedom is Z. Okay, so we know that this V can only be a function of Z in a Cartesian coordinate system. This has to be equal to zero. Well, this is one of the trivial partial differential equations associated with the homogeneous Laplace equation. So this as a result gives us that V of Z, let's call it actually V1, because we are in region 1, V1 of Z has to be equal to two parameters, because it's second order, alpha 1, Z plus beta 1. Okay, you can convince yourself that this becomes a simple second derivative, total second derivative, so obviously it has to be of this type, a linear function. Okay, so alpha 1 Z plus beta 1. So this is the electrostatic potential with two unknowns on region 1. So the first thing we've done, we used in the vacuum region the Laplace equation. And again, caveat, I'm extending it all the way into the conductor, assuming that it's very small, okay? All right, so now, the second thing we want to do, we want to use Coulomb's theorem, okay? Which is a boundary condition, if you want. So let's use Coulomb's theorem. So Coulomb's theorem now, where do we use it? We are approaching capital gamma 1 from capital sigma 1L from the left of that, so we need to do the limiting integral. In Coulomb's theorem, we do the integral. In this case, since it's an infinite surface, or very large, we're not going to put a circle, because it would make no mathematical sense, so we just call it capital sigma 1 left. Is it minus or is plus? Of course it's minus, because I'm approaching from the left, so it's minus, this is in the limit. Okay. Now here I want to compute in general, the directional derivative with respect to n 1 left of V1, which we already know is only function of z, dA. Okay, this is my Coulomb's theorem. However, now we can specialize this Coulomb's theorem with respect to the specific coordinate system we've chosen here, which is 0z, n1l, and of course we need to remember that there is a minus sign. So Coulomb's theorem, when we use it, with the potential, we need to get a minus sign here, so there's a minus sign. But also, we need to express n1l with respect to this coordinate system, which is minus uz, okay? So this directional derivative picks up another minus sign, so the minus sign due to the directional derivative because of this, and the minus sign because of Coulomb's theorem cancel each other. So effectively, we have two minus signs, which cancel each other. Let's write this piece one time here, not to make mistakes. Minus, the partial derivative of course becomes the total derivative with respect to z, because that's the only degree of freedom we have, of what is alpha v1, is nothing but alpha 1z plus beta 1 dA. This quantity, minus minus, is plus the derivative of alpha 1 z plus beta 1, of course beta 1 we get rid of it, that's why it's always good to use Coulomb's theorem to get rid of this extra constant. And so we get just alpha 1 with a positive sign. So we get alpha 1 integral. Now the limit is gone, because we already computed it in the limit. So it's simply over this surface, dA. Now we can take into account for the physics of the problem from Coulomb's theorem again. And so this has to be equal to the integral on capital sigma 1 left of the charge density on that surface. On this surface, we have no charge density. So 0 dA. Coulomb's theorem, this has to be divided by epsilon naught. So clearly, 0 is a constant, this is giving me 0. This alpha is a constant, alpha 1 has to be equal to 0, which means from this Coulomb's theorem, we find that in that region 1, alpha 1 is equal to 0. So V1 of Z can only be equal to beta 1. Now, the reason why I kept this little thickness T here is because I want to remind myself that actually this is a conductor in microscopic electrostatic equilibrium after reaching, for example, if I charge it in this fashion, I could charge it in many different ways, after reaching steady state conditions. Well, this block of, let's say, copper has to be all at the same potential. So these surfaces of this object are equipotential surfaces, okay? Which means if I were to compute because of MEE, if I were to compute V1 right on this surface, which is at z equals 0, this obviously has to give me a constant, which is arbitrary, V1. Whenever I don't put parentheses with z or point, it means it's a constant. And this has to be equal to the only thing left over here, which is beta 1. So beta 1 has to be equal to capital V1. So this is the first solution for region 1. found the first solution here. And let's stress the fact that this V1 is arbitrary. There will be another constant coming up soon, which is not arbitrary due to the continuity of the electrostatic potential. So now we can study the second region, which is region 2. So in this case, if again we solve the Laplace equation, we obtain a solution which is going to be similar to this, but with different parameters, which we need to find. So V2 of Z is equal to alpha 2 Z plus beta 2. We want to find these two parameters, alpha 2 and beta 2. As always, in order to find alpha 2, we need to use Coulomb's theorem. Coulomb's theorem in this case is on this surface, capital sigma 1 R, okay? So we need to do the derivative as always. Let's do this one more time. So it's minus the integral on capital sigma 1 right in the limit from the right, which is plus of the directional derivative with respect to n 1 right, which in this case coincides with uz of v2 of z dz. So in this case, this directional derivative becomes simply a plus, so we get a minus from Coulomb's theorem, integral in the limit, sigma 1 r plus, of, instead of minus, plus, because I'm going in that direction, with respect to z of alpha 2 z plus beta 2, dA. This as always allows me to get rid of this beta 2, so we obtain nothing but minus alpha 2 in this case, minus alpha 2, which is a constant, integral, limit is gone, already computed it, sigma, of course in the limit z, I get rid of z by the derivative, so the limit is the same as the constant there, right? So limit is gone, dA, and this has to be equal to now the physics of the problem. Now here we want to compute the charge on that surface, which is going to be the surface integral on capital sigma 1r, also not in the limit, of plus sigma, which is what we have on this surface here, dA, divided by epsilon naught. So this one clearly gives us, since sigma is a constant, and I can take it outside here, so we have integral on the same surface of dA, that's the same area, divided by epsilon naught, alpha 2 is minus sigma over epsilon naught. So we obtain minus sigma over epsilon naught from this simple calculation, times z, plus beta 2. Now, because of the continuity of the electrostatic potential, the electrostatic potential has to be a continuous function. So we know that when we stitch him up with, when we stitch up this region with the previous region, they have to be the same at the boundary, which is at z equals 0. So if I were to compute V2 at z equals 0, I obtain beta 2. This, because of the continuity of the electrostatic potential, has to be the same as V1, at that shared boundary, which is again for z equals 0. And so in that case, we just obtain capital V1. And so the final result here is minus sigma over epsilon naught, which should not surprise us because we calculated already for the Helmholtz double layer, so it was negative slope with this slope here, sigma over epsilon naught negative, plus beta 2, which is plus V1. So now we have the solution for the second region, region 2. Beautifully spelled out. Here it is. And finally, we need to do the same procedure for region 3, the same procedure as in region 1. So this, I will basically let you do it, is rather simple. So again, it's basically the copy of this one. We solve again the Laplace equation, we get a function which is going to be, I will only give you the highlights. So V3 of Z, which has to be equal to alpha 3, z plus beta 3. You use Coulomb's theorem, we got rid of beta 3, so it allows us to calculate alpha 3, but there is no charge on this region. We are doing this, of course, in the region 3, which means we are doing it on capital sigma 2r, okay? So there is no charge there, so as always, we obtain that alpha has to be equal to 0, exactly like here. Again, if you do it mathematically, note that while in this case we had n1l, which points in this direction, so it's negative here, n2r points in this direction, which is positive, so you need to keep forming the minus sign, whereas here it cancels out, but since again the result is 0, it wouldn't matter. So you just get simply beta 3. Now the question is, The electrostatic potential has to be a continuous function everywhere, so we need to stitch up this with region 2. So is this beta 3 as arbitrary as beta 1 was? The answer is no, because of this continuity condition. So we need to impose that V3 at Z equal D okay, which neglecting this T is basically this distance here, is this surface. At this surface, it has to be, so this quantity of course is equal to beta 3. This has to be equal to V2 at the same boundary which is shared between V1 and V2 and V3. So this is D, okay, and so this has to be equal minus sigma or epsilon naught D plus V1. So obviously beta 3 is equal to this quantity, okay? So the solution is basically spelled out here. The only thing you need to remember is that V3 at Z is equal to a constant quantity. Does it make sense? Yes, because we know that the electrostatic field is zero, and so it has to be constant there, the electrostatic potential. Now, I start to think a little bit, if I had a little bit of a thickness, which is still very small, is the electrostatic potential constant inside the conductor? Is the field zero? Think about that, which is related to the first question I had for you. All right, so now we have these solutions everywhere. They're all continuous, which is nice. Another thing which I would like you to discuss in Piazza among yourselves is, for example, I calculated alpha 2 only by means of Coulomb's theorem on this surface. Now, you could also calculate this alpha 2 by means of Coulomb's theorem on this surface. And so the question which I have for you on Piazza is use Coulomb's theorem on this surface. You should verify that you get a gain minus sigma over epsilon naught. If you don't, then there's something wrong. And the reason why I want you to do there is because here, this n to left here points again against uz, so it's minus uz, and so you need to keep in mind this switch of signs, okay? So please do that. Okay, so now basically the problem is solved. We are at the end of this problem. So the last thing we want to do, you've done all these beautiful calculations to refine in one more different way that the electrostatic potential, let's plot it here, for this double layer, okay, is given by something which is a constant here, and as always I plot it on top of this other plot here. Now the electrostatic potential has to be, so this is my V function of Z, has to be constant all the way to this interface, is continuous, so here I can put a full dot, then it goes down, let's say, like that, all the way to this point continuously, and here the slope goes as minus sigma over epsilon naught, this is the slope here, and then here it goes continuously there, so this point here is capital V1, which is arbitrary, and here, of course, we have capital B1 minus sigma of epsilon of D. So this other point is not arbitrary because I need to stitch it up in a continuous fashion. Okay, so from that, the aim was, we want to calculate the capacitance C of this object. That's what we wanted to compute. So how do we proceed? Well, we know that the definition of the capacitance C is Q, the positive charge, divided by delta B, where delta B is, let's spell it out, is the potential on the positive surface minus the one on the negative surface, and this is the positive charge. So let's remember that the charge, we can use this relationship here, and let's remember that this is the positive surface. So we want to compute this potential difference, which is the potential at this surface here, capital sigma 1r. So right there, the potential is given by B1. Okay, let's do it. So we are at zero. So for example, we can choose either V1 or V2 at zero. V2 at zero, it gives exactly capital B1. Okay, minus the electrostatic potential at this surface, capital sigma 2L, which is the negatively charged surface. So there we are at D, so we need to use, for example, the potential in region 2. So in region 2, we go at D, so we get minus sigma over epsilon naught V plus V1, but with a minus sign in front of it, so we get plus sigma over epsilon naught V minus V1, so V1 and V1 cancel out. And up here we have Q plus, but Q plus we can rewrite it as sigma A. Okay? So that this sigma cancel out. And so the final result for the capacitance is going to be, this B goes away, so it's A d over epsilon naught, we can invert it, so it's epsilon naught A divided by D. Okay? So the capacitance, in this case, of this parallel capacitor, that's a very important result. So let me double stress it. The capacitance is directly proportional to the area. So the bigger the area, the bigger the capacitance. The larger the distance, the smaller the capacitance. So if you want a larger capacitance, you want to make these plates closer to each other. And depends, so this depends on the geometry, as we always say, and on the technology, which in this case is very simple, the materials. It's just the vacuum, which is contained within here. So we are doing it for epsilon naught, okay? This was vacuum, the region in between, so it's epsilon naught. As we shall see in 342, if I were to fill up this region with a dielectric material, with an insulator, I managed by doing so to increase the capacitance by some prefactor, which is an epsilon r, which is the relative permittivity of any dielectric material, the relative dielectric constant, sorry, of any dielectric material. So if you want to increase the capacitance, you can either make them closer or fill it up with an insulated material. And of course, depending on the insulated material, you can make it even bigger than with other materials. But that's the result which we really wanted to find. So this is our capacitance for a parallel plate capacitor. So to summarize this video, we now wanted to use all the knowledge we acquired up until now in this course to find the capacitance of parallel plate capacitor. This is the symbol for this capacitor. So we started with the realistic scenario where we have two plates of finite area with finite thickness. We then made some assumptions. In the limit, these assumptions effectively allow us to model this as if they were two infinite plane of charge, which we already studied before. So that's why we can do the electrostatic field simply, because we've done it before. But I wanted to use the Dirichlet problem as an exercise, so I split this in three regions. Before doing that, though, we really made a nice discussion about how to charge this capacitor with a battery, like a 3-volt battery or a 9-volt battery. And the key question which I had for you is, after reaching a steady condition with this battery, will the charge be on both sides of these conducting plates or only on one side? Okay, and again, these plates are considered to be very large in these approximations. So then we end up looking at the Dirichlet problem in the three regions, which comprises solving the Laplace equation for a symmetric case. So it's simple, alpha z plus beta type. Then in order to find the coefficient alpha, we always use Coulomb's theorem, which allows us to get rid by means of derivation of beta. When you do it with respect to coordinate system, be careful with the signs. So then in this case, we use microscopic electrostatic equilibrium to define V1, which has to be a constant arbitrary. Whereas in this case down here, we use the continuity of the electrostatic potential to stitch up the solution with the previous one, which allows us to find also beta 2. And finally, we proceed in the similar fashion for the third region. Then we obtain this electrostatic potential, the difference between these two plates in potential, which is delta V. This, which I divide Q by that quantity, gives me the capacitance, which is C equal epsilon naught A over D. That's it.